We begin this morning with housing. Housing was one of the defining issues of the 2017 election. After 6 years in government, Labor has substantially increased the development and supply of social housing. But many kāinga ora projects still face significant community opposition. Earlier this week, a 48-home development in East Tāmaki went up in flames, and I asked Housing Minister Megan Woods about the impact of the fire.
Well, it will be 48 fewer homes, but when we put this against the build that we are doing, well, the loss of any home out of our pipeline is not something I celebrate. I know that we have got a really strong pipeline of delivery coming through in Auckland. It is both tragic and frustrating, though, that we know there is such a need for these homes that they're not going to be available for families to move into.
The blaze is being treated as suspicious by Fire and Emergency, and I know this development in particular was subject to intense opposition from some residents in the area. Do you see any connection there?
Look, obviously there's an active investigation underway. That wouldn't be appropriate for me to comment, but what I do know is that I think that across the country that we are seeing communities being fuelled by some political rhetoric around opposing kāinga ora developments. I think within the opposition we've got about six MPs that actively have opposed KO developments going into their electorates. I think that if all of us in Parliament who purport to be serious about solving a housing crisis, it's really needed as political leadership that we need to build houses in order to solve a housing crisis.
You think the opposition to these developments is political, is being driven by political motives?
Some, and in some cases we see the MPs get very involved in the opposition to developments.
Yeah. How much is driven by political opposition?
I think some of it might not start with members of Parliament, but then they see there's something that they can, a local issue that they can jump into. But sometimes, I mean, I've had opposition to developments here in my own electorate, but sometimes your job is actually to show leadership and to talk to communities about why it is that we need those homes and actually seek to allay the fears, not fuel them.
What are the greatest fears that you hear from communities?
So some of it is around the size of the buildings, so whether or not they're going to be two or three, where they're going to be on a section, what are they going to do to sunlight of neighbours, and that is a really easy conversation. You can show plans, you can work through with the neighbouring community and neighbours exactly what is going on. So I think making sure there's good information flows. Some of it is because of some of the rhetoric we're hearing about who's moving into the property. But one of the things that I always talk to people about is actually of all the tenants that we have in our kāinga ora homes, we always have to remember half of them are children. That this is where half of, that half of our tenants are kids finding a warm, safe place that they can call home.
Just going through some of the developments that have faced heavy opposition in the last year, the likes of Millwater, Blockhouse Bay, Rotorua, Ohakune, Hastings, Palmerston North, that is just a selection. Do you think people who oppose these relatively large-scale developments in these communities have any reason to be concerned about the nature of the tenants who are going to be moving into these buildings?
Well, I guess one of the things that I always start a conversation with people, and I take people's fears seriously. I think that there are conversations that do need to be worked through to tease out what people's fears are. That people move into properties in your street all the time when they're privately either owner-occupied or rentals, and the community doesn't get to pick and choose who their neighbour is going to be. But when you actually work through the statistics in terms of the number of places that we have in terms of the kāinga ora homes, that actually 95% of our tenants we never get a complaint about, and exactly what the processes are if there are complaints, what we can do around those. And I mean, there's been some numbers that have been bandying around in terms of the numbers of complaints. Some of those are for not mowing lawns, some of those are for not collecting mail out of the mailbox, and some of those are for a noisy lawnmower or a car that's too loud. Of the serious complaints, when you look at the number of tenancies we have, they are a tiny proportion, and we have to take those seriously, and we do. And it's something that I talk with KO and with kāinga ora about all the time, because everybody deserves to feel safe in their home.
How do large-scale developments affect the property prices around them?
Well, actually, there's some quite interesting research. There's some research out out of the University of Canterbury, which I'm interested in knowing a bit more about, actually, that actually shows that it has an increase in the property value in the area. So I think some people jump...
Really?
Yeah, because what it can often do is it's about upgraded amenity that goes into the area as well. Often the infrastructure is upgraded, all those kind of things, and intensification, if that's going in as well, that can also lead to higher property
the
values.
The intensification thing is the concern for many residents, though, right? As opposed to state housing in the past, when you had a single house on a relatively large section, a lot of these developments are much more intensive, which means you have many more people moving into these buildings once they're finished. And even if you have just a small fraction who are bringing perhaps antisocial or unsavoury behaviours to the community, that can be quite affecting.
And we're really careful about that. So as we are intensifying, so if we look at some of our large-scale projects in Auckland, that you look at sort of a Mount Ross School or a Northcote, we're not simply redeveloping all the land that we have, or Mangere, redeveloping all the land that we have for public housing. We're also putting in affordable homes for home ownership. We're looking to build those mixed communities and then looking to buy land where we haven't had state houses for a long period of time, so that we're not grouping everything together. So I think that's one of the things working through with communities as well, that sometimes these are more mixed developments, that we want those communities. But Jack, when you're building the largest number of state houses that any government has since Walter Nash in the 1950s, that this isn't, I think what we can see, this isn't something that people have been used to in the last couple of decades, a state house build program, because actually we had a reduction in the number of state houses in the decade preceding when we were in government. So to actually see more state housing being added, I guess, is a new thing for a number of neighbourhoods and communities, and something that I'm really aware that for we have to make sure that we are bringing communities with us and spending the time to have that conversation.
The government's spending roughly $1 million a day on emergency housing people in motels. The social housing waitlist is currently sitting at 24,000, which is slightly down from its peak, but including a period in which New Zealand had its borders shut, no immigration other than returning citizens. 24,000 is four times higher than when you came to government. What does it say about the capacity of your government to actually create meaningful change, that 6 years since you came to power on a promise to fix the housing crisis, the social housing list is close to the highest it's ever been?
Yeah, and I don't think anyone for a moment believes that those people have been created in the last 5 years. We're in my electorate.
Certainly that list has, though, right?
The list definitely
has. It's quadrupled.
It has quadrupled.
Under your government.
Jack, we're sitting in my electorate office where I sat here as an opposition MP, meeting with people who couldn't even get on the state house waiting list under a national government. They simply were denied access to be able to enter onto that list. That is not the case today.
See, this is like the crime rate argument, though. It's all down to measurement rather than actual need.
No, it's not about measurement. You can actually, in terms of the ability to get on that list, to actually identify the need and to actually lay that out in front of us. But that number is huge, 24,000 people who are waiting for a state house. But I always do go back to the fact that part of fixing the housing crisis, and particularly for those who require state housing, is getting on and building them. We've built 13,000.
You've built 13,000?
No, sorry. We have added net across both KO and CHIPS. We've added 13,000.
Okay,
period of time.
Let's break down this number. So you've added 13,000. Now, KO is Kāinga Ora, which is government-owned. CHIPS are community housing providers, which get some funding through different government mechanisms. So 13,000 you've added. How many of those are redirects?
None for KO. So it's the
none for KO.
No.
But so our audience is aware, a redirect is when a community housing provider essentially rents a house off the private market. So about 4,500 of that 13,000 are redirects.
So not all redirects are renting off the private market. So you can have a look for a community housing provider, like here in Christchurch, the Otatahi Community Housing Trust. It's when those houses transfer from being council housing into receiving income-related rent subsidies. So they're not all rentals from the private market.
Right, but it's reasonable to say that a large number would be, right?
Actually, probably a big number of them them are coming
through. So what percentage
of
the 4,500 would be rented off the private market?
Oh, look, I don't have that right in front of me, but what I can tell you, if we have a look at OCHT, which is the Otatahi Community Housing Trust, they're all publicly owned and they're being transferred in, but happy to get that number for you.
That's okay, but I mean, so 13,000 new houses is the net add, you say, so 4,500 are redirects, some of which are houses that have just been rented off the private market, so aren't adding to supply in any way. 1,800 are buy-ins, which is when Kāinga Ora just buys a house, so you're not building a house. The government has sold or demolished 4,700 houses. I'm not arguing there hasn't been a net increase to the total number of social houses in New Zealand. I think everyone agrees with that, and if you look at the numbers, it's clear you have added to the total number. But when you say we've added 13,000, it's not quite correct.
No, it is, Jack, because there is a net increase of 13,000. It is absolutely correct. Where I'd be playing games with numbers is if I was talking about the gross numbers. We're very careful to take out when we talk about how many we've added. But, Jack, I agree with you about the renting and the fact that we need these to be new builds, and that's why I've changed the settings in the time that I've been Minister, both for Kāinga Ora, but also particularly for our community housing providers, to say that actually we want a preference on new builds and we want a preference on ownership of those properties. So under the previous governments, the settings were very much around leases. I very much want to see our community providers building balance sheets, so we have changed those settings to make sure that we are actually building our way out of a housing crisis, because that ultimately is the way we fix it.
I'm just going to look at one more number there. So you say often that the previous government sold or demolished houses. I mean, just to be totally clear, your government has done the same thing. 4,772 state houses have been sold or demolished. Some of those have been replaced with more intensive developments. That's absolutely true, but it's not entirely accurate to say that your government hasn't sold houses as well.
Look, we make absolutely no secret of the fact that we are pulling down houses all through
New
Zealand, to redevelop them in terms of building more houses.
Are you selling them as well?
We have sold a few, but when you have a look, that is a net increase. Very few properties have been sold. So I want to put this in perspective. When we talk about the previous government sell-off of state houses, they ended 9 years in office with 1,500 fewer houses than they started with. That's not even taking account for the numbers that were transferred to CHIPS. That is 1,500 fewer than we started with. In 6 years, we're ending up with 13,000 more than we started with. So I think to any allegations that we're doing a state house sell-off, do we sell houses where it makes absolutely no sense for us to have that house? Yes, we do, but we are replacing them at a far greater rate.
I'm not alleging you're undertaking a state house sell-off. All I'm saying is there are nuance to those numbers, right? And when you see those headline numbers, especially heading into an election campaign, they can be a little misleading if you don't appreciate some of that nuance.
Oh, well, I think that, of course, if we're going to redevelop the land we owned, we have to demolish the building that's on it. So I think if we were sitting here and I was giving you our gross numbers, this is how many houses we've added. And
but it's the redirects. I mean, a third of those new houses that you claim are redirects.
This is policy settings that were set up under the previous government. As I said, I've changed those settings because I don't think that is the way in which that we do fix the housing crisis, but we have to honour the contracts that were entered into from the previous government. I do think there is an element of shifting deck chairs, and that's not the way our government has approached fixing the housing crisis.
24,000 is the housing register at the moment. On your current rate of adding houses to that total social housing pool, when will the housing register be cleared?
Well, we won't only clear the housing register by building state houses, and I think that's also one of the big programs of work that we've been on. That before we had the changes that happened under the national government, where you had community providers and Housing New Zealand start to compete essentially for income-related rent subsidies, that we used to have social housing, which was affordable rentals, which were provided by church and community groups and councils. I think that that was actually one of the casualties of that period of our history, and that's a bit we're seeking to rebuild. So it's not all. When we talk about state house numbers, we're actually talking about how many are funded through income-related rent subsidy.
I understand.
So what I also want to do is rebuild that bit of the sector where we can once again get these groups like churches and councils who can offer affordable housing that isn't income-related rent subsidy, and we've got funding going out at the moment to help those organisations build those houses.
So to the question, when will the social housing register be cleared?
Look, as quickly as it can. We're starting to see it come down.
Which is what? Are we talking 5 years at the current momentum? A decade?
So what we know is that we're building around 3,000 a year now, which is a large number of state houses to be added. We will have by the end of 2025, which is where our funding goes out to, there'll be 21,000 houses that will have been added at that time. But I don't want to just count this. My point, Jack, is I don't want to just count this on the rate of state house build, because I think there's other things
with all of those policy settings, what would be a reasonable time to expect that social housing register to be cleared?
Well, I think we need to see it coming down in the next 2 and 3 years. I think we need to see that starting to come down.
Cleared.
In terms of cleared, I can't give you a date on that. We need to be pulling all the levers we can, and I can't give you a date because it's not a simple linear connecting the dot between the build programme and a point in time on the calendar, because we need to make sure that we're not just relying on our public house build programme to do it.
Quote, "I refuse to stand by while children are living in cars." That was Jacinda Ardern in 2017, at which time there were 102 public housing applicants, who listed their address as being a vehicle living in a car. In June of this year, 480 housing applicants told the authorities that they were living in their cars. The number of New Zealanders living in cars has quadrupled since you came to power. Why?
So that number is when someone goes into MSD and they're asked about their current living situation. Nobody stays in a car anymore, that there is emergency housing for them to go into. So that is the data you're looking at, is the information that is collected when they go into MSD.
So you're saying that no one in New Zealand is living in a car?
Nobody has to. That's when they go into MSD and say that they need to talk to someone about housing. That's the data that is collected there. The difference with the period in time before those numbers, the 100-something number you're using, is, of course, what brought the National Party, when they were in government, into first starting using motels, because there was no alternative for these people who were living in their cars. We didn't have emergency housing, and when they did bring it in, it was capped. We've expanded that. Obviously, I don't want to see any child living in a car. I don't want to see any child living in a motel. Mm. And that's why we are so focused on fixing the housing crisis. But I think in terms of saying that they have to continue to live in their cars, that is not the case at all. And that's part of the criticism that we get, actually, for our motel bill. But you know what? I would have a child living in a motel over a car any day of the week. I don't want them staying in motels, and that's why we're so dedicated to our build program.
The Healthy Home Standards were introduced by Labor as an effort to improve housing conditions across the country. In the second part of our interview, I asked Housing Minister Megan Woods if landlords are complying with the laws.
When you lodge a bond application as a landlord, you have to fill in you have to actually fill that detail in terms of...
You tick a box, right, and say, yes, my house is compliant.
You actually have to go through a calculation in terms of whether or not your home meets that standard in terms of what the insulation is like.
But that's an honesty box system, right?
It is an honesty box, but we also do need landlords to be honest, and I don't think any of us would think that was an unrealistic expectation. We ask people to make declarations all over the place in terms of their lives when they're filling in. But we are doing some checks.
Yeah, some checks. So according to written questions of New Zealand's total rental stock, about 1 in 500 was checked for compliance in the year to May 2023. One in 500.
Yeah, and I mean, there is more we can do around checking, and that is something I would like us to do more on. But also, Jack, I am going to put this back on. I don't think it is too much to expect that when we ask people to fill in a statutory form, that they're telling the truth.
Well, it is if you look at the number of people who are failing, or landlords who are failing the Healthy Home Standard. So of all of those checks in the year to May 2023, 53% were breaching the standards.
Yeah, and they were checked. So we are prioritising the homes where there are complaints. So where there is a
of the 53%, two-thirds of the checks were not
complaints.
So only a third had actually come from a complaint.
I don't have that data in front of me.
So I've got it here. That is remarkable, given the government is, for example, purchasing ads warning landlords that they might face consequences if their house doesn't comply with the Healthy Home Standards. Wouldn't greater enforcement be more effective as a strategy?
Absolutely, and there is a cost with that. So that what we do have to also ask is that people, when they are filling in their forms, I don't think it is too much to ask people to tell the truth. We ask people to do that all over the show in terms of forms they fill into government, and there's not an expectation necessarily that the taxpayer also has to pick up the tab of going and checking on them. I think there is more we can do in compliance. I'm not disagreeing with you on that, but what I am going to push back a little bit on is that some of the onus actually sits with the landlords who are not fulfilling their obligations to ensure that they are offering a warm, dry
You're just
rental.
Asking landlords to do the right thing here, and there are many landlords who will say, if someone is willing to rent this property, perhaps at a lower rate than would be expected if it complied with all of the Healthy Home Standards, why would I bother upgrading my house if there's a 0.2% chance of it being inspected?
Well, I think we've got to a sad point where if the only way that we can have compliance on any issue is because you're only going to do it if the government are going to come round and check on you. We ask people to fill in the truth in tax forms. We ask people to, and not everyone gets investigated by the IRD. So I think that is.
But 53% of people aren't lying in their tax returns, are they? I mean, that's the thing. If you've got 53% of inspected properties breaching those Healthy Home Standards, surely that is an indication that you need greater enforcement.
Jack, I'm not arguing with you that we do need to make sure that we've got enforcement and compliance, but I'm saying some of the responsibility actually does lie with people that are filling in the forms to tell the truth, and I don't think that's too much to ask people.
When we last spoke with you, we talked about Rotorua's Golden Mile, Fenton Street, and we asked specifically about Tiny Dean, who is the owner of a security company and the CEO of Visions of a Helping Hand, which is an emergency housing provider in Rotorua. Reporting by our colleagues on Sunday revealed he had been employing gang associates as security guards. The authority which regulates security companies has now found that Tiny Dean engaged two security guards whom he knew were linked to gangs without proper licences, and he let them keep working after their licence applications were declined. How can you justify using Visions of a Helping Hand as an emergency provider?
So the first is we have agencies that do that licensing for precisely this reason. That is to have those checks and balances around people who are doing these jobs. So I think, first of all, we can say that that process has kind of done what it needs to do. What is happening now is that officials from the Ministry of Housing and Urban Development, who are the contracting agency around what we're doing in Rotorua, are in, I think nobody would be surprised to know they're in conversations with Visions of a Helping Hand in terms of talking about what that contract looks like and how that's going to work through it. And I'm due to receive an update on that in the coming weeks in terms of where those discussions are going to. So this is something that I have asked officials to work with their agency so that we can ensure that everybody is being kept safe.
Just to be totally clear, he has stood down temporarily from the CEO role at Visions.
Yes.
Will you continue to support that provider if he returns to the CEO role?
As I said, Jack, I've asked for some detailed work to be done, to work with the board, and I'll be getting a report back on that soon. It's certainly something I'm aware of and something that I'm committed to making sure that we're doing the right thing.
Housing was arguably the issue of the 2017 election, and Labor came in with massive promises to tackle the housing crisis. Kiwi build, renters' rights, no more kids in cars. Relative to income, houses today are more expensive. Rents are at record highs. Of your 100,000 Kiwi Build target, you have more than 98,000 houses still to build. You've introduced renters' rights, but are barely enforcing them. There are four times as many people on the social housing waiting list, and you're spending $1 million a day on emergency housing providers. By all of those metrics, things are worse than in 2017. So why should anyone believe that Labor has the capacity to improve the state of housing in New Zealand?
Well, Jack, there's so many places I could start in that list of things that you've just read out. The other one I'm going to give you in terms of metrics is 1 in 7 public houses in New Zealand have been added by our government. When we consider that this is a build program that has been going on since the 1930s, I think that is a truly astonishing number. In terms of the Kiwi Build,
all those other metrics are headed in the wrong way.
So, Jack, I think Kiwi Build, okay, it's the easiest political hit in the country. The target is no longer 100,000, and you know that, that we did a reset of that.
But it wasn't an election campaign, and we're heading into another election campaign now. You came in on these massive promises, and by going through all those critical metrics, not just Kiwi Build, housing affordability.
I'm going to take Kiwi Build then, Jack. So one of the things that we do know is that actually Kiwi Build, or the government underwrite, is incredibly important as we go into the kind of the downside of the housing cycle, that when we had a hot housing market like we'd had in the previous couple of years, the developers really didn't need de-risking tools. But actually, that we are seeing a big upswing in terms of developers needing this to get funding and financing across the line. What that does is it ensures that we don't see what happened after the GFC, where affordable housing just fell off the radar, that people went to the least risky part of the market, and no one can blame them for that. But with Kiwi Build, we are still seeing affordable homes come through in that build program. But
compared to the target that was sold to New Zealand voters heading into the 2017 election.
That.
Yeah, you reset it once you're in government.
Yes.
But the point is that going through all of those metrics, and I mean, it's not just the Kiwi Build, it's housing affordability. I mean, the median multiple houses are inarguably more expensive relative to incomes than in 2017.
To what has happened with housing affordability around the world.
How does New Zealand compare to when you came to government, 2017?
But Jack, I think you have to look globally of what has happened to house prices post-COVID.
What happened to house prices before COVID, between 2017 and 2020? What happened there?
We saw that massive inflation with house prices happen as the world came out of the economic crisis that COVID had caused. I mean, I think we probably all remember those month-on-month ticking up of house prices. We are seeing that starting to come out. And I think one of the things that we critically have to do is to ensure that we still have supply coming through. And that's why we've put in place not only Kiwi Build, but a bunch of other levers to make sure that as we face those economic headwinds, that we don't see construction fall off and that we actually are seeing construction holding up reasonably well.
Couple of last questions on the campaign. You are Labor's campaign chair. To what extent is your momentum slipping?
Look, I think that campaigns have their own kind of cycle. That obviously the last couple of weeks haven't been ideal scenarios for any campaign. But look, campaigns have to make sure that they're focused on exactly what the plan is, making sure that they're executing that, and to also not panic as you go through the ups and downs of what any campaign will bring. I've been involved in far too many campaigns in my life that throw things that you never expect that are coming at you, that you've got to be prepared for whatever happens. But I think one of the things, I think we're satisfied in terms of how the campaign, in terms of the machinery of the campaign, is rolling out. In fact, I think it's going incredibly well.
Are you running a kind campaign?
We certainly are running a positive campaign. That what we are talking to New Zealand.
Are you running a kind campaign?
If by kind you mean, are we talking to
New Zealanders? Well, you guys set the parameters on kindness in 2020, so are you running a kind campaign?
And I'll answer it kindly. But if you're asking, are we talking about to New Zealanders about the things that matter to them, about how hard that they're finding it at the moment, about the in terms of cost of living, going to the supermarket, how it is that they're getting by, then I think that is incredibly kind, that we are absolutely focused on those cost of living issues that are important to New Zealanders and in terms of what life is like for ordinary
people.
Are
you showing kindness to your political opponents?
I think we are. I think that politics and always has been and always will be an incredibly robust environment. I like to see that robust exchange being about the exchange of ideas and not focused on people.
Was it kind for you to compare women's rights under a Prime Minister, Christopher Luxon, to the Handmaid's Tale dystopia?
So, as I said, I think that politics, when it comes to an exchange of ideas, should be robust. Am I going to call into...
Was that kind?
Was it kind in terms of...
Was it kind for you to post that?
Saying that we are going to start charging for contraception again. That was not focused on an individual. It was focused on a policy idea. And we should always have an exchange of ideas, Jack. That is exactly what elections are about, and I stand by that.
Damien O'Connor, Greg O'Connor, Adrian Drew Duffy, Jenny Salisa, Rino Tinikatene, Jamie Strange, Nanaia Mahuta, the list goes on. Those are colleagues of yours who opposed abortion reform. Were they deserving of Handmaid's Tale memes?
Look, I think we were talking about a particular policy around access to contraception. The tweet was after Christopher Luxon said that National wouldn't continue with free prescriptions for contraception for everybody.
Was New Zealand living under a Handmaid's Tale dystopia for the 5 years of the Labor government in which those prescriptions also weren't funded?
No, but when you're faced with the choice about whether you're going to put it back on.
You were also faced with the choice during those 5 years. I mean, you just waited until this budget to remove that thing, so you also had that choice for 5 years.
Of course, political parties have to phase in all the policies they bring in, but when faced with a choice, when asked the question, Christopher Luxon said he would put those charges back on.
I want to ask you who's going to win Ilam, but I suspect I know your answer. So who's going to come second in Ilam?
I think Ilam's going to be a really interesting seat to watch. I think that it hasn't traditionally been a Labor seat. It's one that we picked up in 2020, but we've had an incredibly hard-working Member of Parliament that's been in there, and Sarah Pallett, that she's worked really hard in terms of getting to know constituents. I think in terms of for second, I think it's going to be interesting because I think the Greens will also be particularly strong in Ilam. If you look at the party growth vote and the growth of the party vote over time in Ilam, you can see that has been growing. So I think that if you put that mix of kind of the National top and the Greens in for second, I think it's going to be a really interesting mix.